All right, we have the legendary Professor Griff in the building from one of my favorite groups, you know, rap or otherwise, Public Enemy. How's everything?
Everything's good, man. I'm about the legend part. I'm trying to live up to that. Yeah.
Well, you've lived up to it already, I think. You look great, by the way. I actually looked you up on Wikipedia. You're 56 years old. You look 35.
Oh, thanks, man. But Wikipedia, I wouldn't do Wikipedia, man. Anybody could put anything on Wikipedia. I read some stuff on Wikipedia about myself. I'm like, that ain't true. Yeah, so we got to talk to those people, man.
I feel you. Now, I remember the last time I interviewed Chuck D. This was some years ago. And he was telling me how the two of you had a conversation about how, you know, you guys really looked at each other and just kind of thought about how healthy you were and how, you know, a lot of people, a lot of peers are dying. And, you know, we just talked about how Big Psych just died today. You know, so it's definitely, you know, you're a little bit older than me, but, you know, people in our age range are definitely not living healthy and dying very prematurely.
Yeah, and if you do the research, a lot of them are dying in their 40s, man. Heavy D, Guru,
yeah,
and a few other people. I'm like Fife Dog and a few other people. And I don't want to attribute that to the quote-unquote entertainment lifestyle. You understand what I'm saying? Of course, that has some contributing factors to it, but I think it's just overall, man, how you think, of course, what you eat, the mental and the physical food. I mean, part and parcel, you can't, if we separate the entertainment industry and then we say, okay, the people in the entertainment industry are living long lives and everybody else is dying, I guess that wouldn't be anything to talk about. But because we are in the entertainment industry and aspects of our lives, at least 75% of my life is public, which is a good thing, but for publicity's sake, to advance your career. But that's critical, man, because if I get a dead toothache, half the world knows, and that's not good. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But most...
Absolutely.
Most of those people that have passed on have died in their 40s, man, which is not healthy. Not when the Bible says most of us live to be 1,000. 40 is nothing.
Right. Now, before you joined Public Enemy, you had something called the Universal Revolutionary Freedom Fighters Society.
Oh, you going back, bro.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was way, that's when I was a teenager.
Right. So talk about that, because it focused on martial arts and everything else like that. So talk about sort of the meaning behind that and how you got into all that.
Well, the concept was to unite all those freedom fighters from around the globe that were still in their youth to come up under one kind of platform. And in that case, since I didn't do a lot of traveling, it was just one mindset. And that was the impetus and the birth to what happened later on in Public Enemy with the S1Ws. Mm-hmm. You know, Marcus Garvey said, one aim, one destiny, one purpose, one God, race first. That was the mindset. So I put together a group of people that got tired of playing little league football and baseball and wanted to do something serious with their lives. Those people became the foundation to this group I put together after that called Unity Force, and then they became the S1Ws.
Okay. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, before Public Enemy, you were part of the Nation of Islam?
For Public Enemy, I was part of the Nation of Islam, speaking and doing music in a group called Spectrum with Wizard KG from the Bomb Squad. And that's a story not a lot of people know about. No one talks about. So people think people think Chuck got me and we came and did music. No, Chuck was in the audience while we were doing the music.
Aha.
Right.
And of course, the Bomb Squad is the production company behind Public Enemy.
Exactly. Keith Shockley, Hank Shockley, Eric Sadler, Eric Sadler, and there's a few other people.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So
Johnny Juice did some stuff.
So you were actually a rapper in that group?
I never called myself a rapper. I don't even know where that term came from. That's some lollipop, bubblegum shit. Rapper? No. I was a revolutionary.
Okay.
In music.
But you were a vocalist in the group.
Which group are you talking about?
The group before Public Enemy.
Spectrum City?
Spectrum City, right.
We were all DJs.
Ah, okay. So tell me about how it went from Spectrum City to Public Enemy and how Chuck D and Flavor Flav sort of formed into that whole equation.
Well, it really wasn't a Chuck D Flavor Flav thing. I think that's where it gets twisted. It was a Chuck D thing. Chuck, along with Hank Shockley, which is Keith Shockley's brother. Keith was my partner. Chuck and Hank went to Adelphi, and they had the radio show going at Adelphi University. And that's where we all used to come together and meet, like a crew, like, you know, people do all the time. It was Chuck that they offered the deal to, no one else. But he didn't want to sign as Chucky D, which is corny as fuck. But hey, he was like, nah, I'm not doing that. So we just kind of went to in the back room, and he created this concept called Public Enemy and kind of brought the parts together. And since we were already working with one another, the parts were already there. I never worked with Flavor. You understand what I'm saying? Very talented brother. But Flavor had the Flavortrons.
So the Flavortrons. I've never heard of this before.
He had the Flavortrons and the little group and crew that used to follow him, and, you know, they did things together. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So how did Flavor Flav get into the group then?
Flavor and Chuck used to work a physical job together, moving furniture and whatnot. Yeah.
Okay. So he brought Flav in and he became part of Public Enemy.
Yes. And this is all happening, like, you know, real quick. The first Terminator X was my partner, Keith. KG from Spectrum City, part of the Bomb Squad. Mm-hmm. And then that didn't work out. And then Chuck went and was working with Norman Rogers, which is Terminator X. Right.
So you guys put this together, and then you get your first deal with Def Jam Records.
You really can't say a we thing. That was really a Chuck D at the head, bringing Flavor. I worked with Hank and Keith and Spectrum City. We kind of came together. So yeah, the deal that was actually signed with Def Jam was Chuck and Flavor, no one else.
Okay. Now I'd heard, because I remember I read Chuck D's book. I guess Rick Rubin didn't want Flavor Flav in the group. He didn't get it.
Right, no one wanted Flavor. Russell wasn't even on the set. I don't know what the hell he was doing, but Rick didn't want him because he didn't understand it. And it wasn't meant for anybody to understand. We were doing something new. You understand what I'm saying? Ain't nobody brought no damn Uzis on stage and talking black power and that kind of stuff prior to Public Enemy. Wasn't nothing black going on. That's when I hear these cats now, and I'm like, bruh, no. You understand what I'm saying? And it wasn't about being violent. It wasn't about being aggressive towards white America. It was about holding up the mirror to white America and saying, look, this is what you kind of created. This is what's going on out there. We're trying to come up with a solution to a problem that you created.
So Chuck signs Public Enemy to Def Jam. You guys drop Yo Bum Rush the Show.
Right.
And it does well, but not like Nation of Millions well. But Nation of Millions ends up going crazy.
Yeah, but does well according to what standard? If your goal is to come in the industry for 2 years, shake it up and get out. And during the course of this interview, from this day forward, we have to keep that in mind. It was a 2-year project. Whether we live or died, we was gonna shake it up. So Yo Bum Rush the Show was like, okay. It wasn't until Rebel Without a Pause that wasn't even on that album that things start to start moving. Yeah.
Okay. Now, as the first record deal, you know, when you go and release the first album, Yo Bum Rush the Show, what exactly is your role in Public Enemy?
Wow, you got a pen and pad?
Yep.
I was the Minister of Information, and I would kind of gather the information and just kind of funnel it and channel it to Chuck. I tried to at Flavor. Me, different aspects and members of the Bomb Squad would have those discussions. And those are some of the things that formulated the songs. So when you don't see my name on the song, it doesn't mean I didn't contribute. You understand what I'm saying? My name might not be on this interview, but I'm contributing. But the music industry would not give me credit for that. It's not something I'm going to get a royalty check for. But that made up the spirit and the mindset of what we were dealing with at that particular time. And we can't discount that. You understand what I'm saying? When I'm asked sometime, well, what are you? I'm a spirit being having a human experience. I'm God having a human experience. You understand what I'm saying? So the aspect of the songs and the ideas and that kind of thing, a lot of times and most times came from discussions, debates with inside the group on political, different viewpoints and that kind of different perspectives. But I was funneling and channeling information. I was a reader. I did research. Then on top of that, I was the road manager. Then on top of that, I was the security of the lead of the security of the first world. Then on top of that, the whole choreograph thing and the whole. So I wore like 4 or 5 hats, not to take anything away from anybody else. That's what I did. So when people say, how did Public Enemy get started? That's a conversation we need to have like we're having now, because people don't know. That corny fucking story that Def Jam tells, please say that shit.
Right. And the S1Ws, they were on stage with Public Enemy, and it was kind of like a military type thing that you guys were presenting.
Yeah, we weren't coming doing no damn dancing. Hell no, it was serious time. This is desperate time. Desperate times call for desperate measures. And we wanted to show America that we weren't playing. And this ain't no goddamn act.
The second album comes together, Nation of Millions. When you guys were working on it, did you have any idea how big it was going to be?
No, because at that time, we were preparing to make the exit because the 2 years was almost up. But Rebel did so well, we was like, okay, now we got the formula, let's make it happen. And the limited amount of times I did kind of sit in on those long sessions, that creative stuff, you got to give credit to Hank, Chuck, Keith, Eric, Johnny Juice, and a few other people that was up in here, Rick Rubin, of course, and those dynamic engineers that sat behind the board, man, for all them hours, just like, you know, just having Chuck in one ear and Hank in the other ear, and you putting in 20 samples, and it don't seem like it's going together, but it worked, man. But you never know how that stuff is going to be received.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I remember when I interviewed Russell Simmons maybe about a year ago or so. Mm-hmm. I mean, he said that
he wasn't really ready to make the next Public Enemy because they didn't want nobody near them. They were like, get the fuck away from us, all of you niggas. And they made the second Public Enemy album, was the greatest record Def Jam ever made.
Yeah, incredible album.
That's the best record, my Def Jam record. That album is great. The one after it was great, too. Public Enemy made
it takes
the
a nation of millions.
Defined Def Jam, in my opinion.
It takes a nation of millions. Was the second album, yeah.
Yeah, you don't fuck with that.
No.
Oh, the only thing fucks with that is Ice Cube's America's Most
America's
Wanted.
America's Most Wanted, yeah.
It's in the same category. That's them. They made it.
The same producers, yeah.
Of course.
Yeah.
Dumb niggas that made Def Jam more than anybody, the Bomb Squad. Because they didn't make rock and roll or rap or mix it or what. They said, fuck that, we're going to make some new shit.
Yeah, straight hip hop. Well, yes.
Beastie Boys had that in their second album, too, which kind of would have really fit on Def Jam.
Musically, what you guys put together was just on a completely different level.
Yeah, and you're talking about, and we thank Russell for that, but you're talking about years and years of listening to what our parents were playing in the home. Everything from Al Green to Dramatics, Temptations, Tower of Power, Mighty Clouds of Joy, all kind of stuff. So when you listen to a Public Enemy song, shit, you might hear anything, a damn toilet flushing, a scream, or a laugh, or whatever. And then on top of that, you heard Malcolm X, Dr. King, Jesse Jackson, Minister Farrakhan, the Black Panther Party. Then on top of that, by the time you got to the show, it was like Uzis and marching and drilling and flavor all over the place. Then on top of that, Chuck's voice. You understand what I'm saying? and the lyrics, and people resonated with it. It worked.
If you look at hip hop today, for example, and you look at the subject matter, the prominent subject matter in most hip hop songs today, it's very different than the mid 90s, the early 90s, like 92, 93, when Public Enemy was at its height. It was just a different mind state at the time.
Right, because America was different. Because you kind of figure mid 80s, 86, 85, 86, you had AIDS, Africans in deep shit, or America's doing the shit, and crack, chemical and biological warfare hit at the same time. So yeah, things were going to be different. So we came up out of the turbulent, born in the 60s, came through the whack-ass fucking 70s with disco, where they crushed everything culturally speaking, and that cultural expression. So by the time late 70s hit, we were dancing in the street and spinning our heads on cardboard boxes with boom boxes, wearing what we thought was hip-hop gear. You understand what I'm saying? By the time 80s hit, we thoroughly got a grasp on it, and we said, okay, we about to bring the pain. Then America came with the chemical and biological warfare with crack and AIDS, and we said, okay, we got a fight on our hands, so let's bring it. And we did, and we gave birth to a cultural, positive, conscious renaissance at that time. Queen Latifah, KRS-One, Brand Nubians, Poor Righteous Teachers. I mean, Lakim Shabazz preceded that, but there was a few other groups that came out that were extremely positive.
Yeah, I mean, Poor Righteous Teachers, Brand Nubian, like it was a lot during that time.
Exactly. So the women that didn't grab a hold of that stayed on crack, stayed on drugs, did all this. And those are the women that gave birth to the MCs or the rappers that you see today. Drug induced, trauma based. And that's what you're hearing.
So I remember reading Chuck D's book, and he talked about how Flavor Flav was always kind of a loose cannon in the group. And I think there was this one part in the book where Flav showed up like really, really late to a meeting, and you ended up kicking him in the chest.
I don't mean to laugh, man, but no. That's not the way the story went. We're supposed to do a gig, and we were looking for Flavor. And where we lived, Roosevelt, okay, Freeport, Hempstead, it's not that big. So there's only a few places that he could have been. So I put the word out, and I got 20 people looking for this dude. And it's like, I know where he at, Bricktown in Freeport. Take my crew, we go to Bricktown. You got drug dealers, thugs, and all these other kind of people thinking they fucking tough. But nah, dude, you ain't that fucking tough. Move the fuck out the way. We found Flavor up on the roof, getting lit, put him in the car, brought him to the studio, asked him, was he ready to go? End up trying to curse me out. And you remember them big boom boxes? He used to carry that all the damn time. And he had the shit on 15, listening to some whack ass fucking song he probably made. Now I'm only playing. But anyway, he took it off his shoulder and he put it here. And I kicked the box. I wasn't kicking him. But, you know, being angry and mean and kind of, you know, aggressive. You understand what I'm saying? End up kicking him in the chest and whatever, whatever, whatever. So subsequently, he didn't want to go because he thought I was a little bit too violent. And I just was basically asking him and everybody else, either we're going to do this shit or we not. Plain and simple. You understand? And I think at that time became the unraveling of Public Enemy as far as Professor Griff is concerned, because simply put, and I was like, Flavor, I can't fight you and them and deal with our people in the street. I'm trying to hold us together. You gonna work with us or what? Nah, man. The drug was more important.
Right, because, and I remember I'd read an interview with Flav talking about this. When you guys did Night of the Living Bassheads, the music video, which I thought was brilliant. Like artistically, the way that video was put together was just on a different level from anything you've ever seen in a music video before.
Right.
But I guess Flav was talking about that when they were filming that video, he was actually smoking crack during the time. Right. So you have this anti-crack song that Flav is in, but he's actually smoking crack during the filming of it.
Yeah, it's like being ashamed, but when we look at the history of black artists in the music industry, that whole drug element and ingredient was always there. Look at jazz. Do you understand what I'm saying? Look at, you know, the artists that came up with R&B. That element was always there. So, you know, we're not above and beyond it, even with a positive, conscious group like Public Enemy. But what we tried to do and attempted to do was hide it. It's like that problem that your wife or your girlfriend or your brother may have, and the family kind of shields it away until they can get its act together. You understand what I'm saying? But that caused friction between me and Flavor, because you're talking about a man like Professor Griff training martial arts, teaching other people and other students, having a crew of about 50 people. You understand what I'm saying? Ready to move on my word. No drugs, no alcohol, damn near no soda, no meat. Vegetarians thinking positive, and then Flavor come along, come on crack? Now we can't let the world know that. Do you understand what I'm saying? So that dynamic was always there. And Chuck wasn't no social scientist. He did not keep, you know, Flavor at bay and Griff at bay. You understand? And I do have to admit, and I've admitted it over the years, there's a much more mature way I could have handled the situation. But you're thinking, this shit was supposed to last 2 years. We got a window of opportunity. Make it happen. And I'm not going to lose this on trying to get to the people because this dude is on crack. You understand? But you got to understand something. Prior to that, me and my crew was robbing drug dealers. You understand? We didn't give a fuck about that life or them. You were standing in our way. You understand what I'm saying? And either you're going to be part of the problem or the solution. What you going to do?
With those issues, Flav was just a very integral part of the group. Like, I can't really imagine public, you know, I feel there is no Public Enemy without Flav.
And I would agree. And I would
there
agree
is
with
no
you.
Public Enemy without, yeah.
Right, I would agree
I
with
mean,
you.
Like the ad-libs and what Flav brings to the equation can't be duplicated. You can't swap them out with another hype man or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, but you could say that about any integral part of Public Enemy. You can say that about the Bomb Squad.
Right.
You can say that about the mystique of a man, Terminator X, who never spoke.
Right.
You can say that about Professor Griff and the S1Ws. It's like, are you just two rappers and a DJ on stage? But all of it made Public Enemy what it is. You understand what I'm saying?
So, Nation of Millions comes out. And it goes crazy. Like, how many albums did it end up selling?
I don't enough for us to get sued, but we'll talk about that in a minute. But yeah.
Okay. So Nation Million comes out, you know, considered
by
2 million. So it goes multi-platinum. Not only does it sell a lot of copies, but it's critically acclaimed. It's not just a pop album. This was no Ice Ice Baby. This was a critically acclaimed hip-hop masterpiece. So everything just kind of goes crazy after that. Like, what really changed in the group once you had such a huge hit on your hands?
The number one thing, how to handle that.
Yeah.
How do you handle, and this is no, please, there's no disrespect to anyone. How do you handle living in Roosevelt, one square mile, all black, except Howard Stern's white ass. But how do you handle that coming out of Roosevelt? Now you're Public Enemy. You at the concert opening up before the Beastie Boys, 20,000 people in the audience, 99.9% all fucking white, and you say put your fists in the air. How the fuck you handle that? That's culture shock, man. You understand what I'm saying? Most of us ain't never left Roosevelt or Long Island, other than going into the city, to Queens and Brooklyn and Bronx. So how do you handle that? Now you in front of 20,000 people, mostly white. We had very limited interaction with white people. The fucking landlord, the dude on the liquor store, and the laundromat. So come on, man. That's culture shock.
Right, because at one point, Public Enemy was opening up for U2 at the height of U2.
Yeah, but that was later on.
Later on, but it, yeah, but what I'm saying is that you guys are a pro-black group with these huge white stadiums, essentially.
Yeah, but people thought that pro-black meant anti-white, and it don't.
Yeah.
If I love Griff, I'm capable of loving anyone else. But if I don't love me, I'm incapable of loving anyone else because I don't love myself. We said, let's love self first. Not that we made the music and catered it towards a certain specific group of people. It was for everyone. Music is a universal language. Some of the struggles and some of the things and topics that we dealt with on the albums, they were meant for white people. Shit. When we said she watched Channel Zero, black women weren't the only ones watching soap operas. You understand? Light of living basis. Black people weren't the only ones on crack. I know some white crackheads. Shit.
You did an interview after the second album came out, and you made some comments about Jews. You said that Jews are responsible for the majority of the wickedness in the world.
Is it?
Was that part correct?
No, that was a lot longer than that. It was a conversation we were having. So, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I could probably...
So put it into context for me.
In what context? Like the conversation we were having?
Yeah.
You have time for that?
Sure.
I could talk about it.
Go for it.
Huh?
Go for it.
If you are the, one of the main integral parts of Public Enemy that actually did the interviews, and there was a research department in the Nation of Islam that was distributing a manuscript on a book that later came out called The Secret Relationship Between Blacks and Jews. And at that time, there was discussions going on in the group, along with people that was associated with the group. And we was running down who owns the music industry and who owns the production companies and this, that, and the other. So when the interviewer, black man, asks a certain series of questions, I used to travel with suitcases full of books. Hell, I was a minister of information. So I came with 20, 30 books, and we was just kind of going over some of the information in the books. I think I had Henry Ford's book, The International Jew, The Octopus. I can't remember all of the books that I had, but we had that discussion about who controls the entertainment industry. So out of that conversation, which was an hour and 10 minutes long, someone pulled that out and put it in the forefront. You understand what I'm saying?
Right.
So if you're talking about world wars, then who was responsible? If you talk about who financed Hitler, who was responsible? If you're talking about the Civil War and you're talking about black people being brought over from Africa to America in the holds of ships, who owned the insurance companies? Who owned the ships? And that's the kind of discussion we were having.
Okay.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
David Mills made it seem like it was a Jewish conversation. So, yeah.
But it was a bigger story involved in it.
Oh, it's a lot. It was a lot larger than that.
Yeah. But that part comes out, and there's an instant backlash over it. Mm. What started to happen within the group when that backlash started?
I think it was discussions about it, but we looked at it like, okay, our 2-year run is up. We shook shit up. What the fuck, man? It wasn't like people thought it was, because we didn't really have interaction like that with white people. So it didn't mean anything. It was like, okay. It wasn't until that information was sent to the Village Voice in New York, then it exploded. And then now those Jewish groups, ADL and other people, put pressure on Def Jam to figure out how you're gonna handle Public Enemy. Then Public Enemy had to figure out how do you handle Griff. And I'm like, what is it to handle? Our 2-year reign is up. See you, and it wasn't nothing to even talk about. But since Chuck flipped it and I got thrown under the bus, now I gotta go for myself. 50 soldiers that I thought I had didn't have them anymore. Hmm. Do you understand what I'm saying?
What do you mean?
You talk about Professor Griff, leader of the S1Ws, the same dude that was training people in martial arts and going to prisons and jails and leaving money on the books. Hardcore killers getting out of jail like, yo, whatever you need me to do, Griff. Yeah, I had those kind of dudes at my, waiting on my word. What do you do with that kind of power? Pseudo power.
Okay.
And now you got the dudes in the group throwing you under the bus? Yeah, if I was kind of reckless with my mouth at that time, yeah, there'd have been some funerals happening, bro, for real. But no, I pulled back, and as I was pulling back, thinking that the group was going to be over anyway after 2 years, I find out that I was the one getting kicked out of the group.
Now, I'd heard that Chuck D didn't want you out of the group. Is that true?
No, he didn't.
Yeah.
That's true, he didn't. Mm-mm.
So the other people wanted you out of the group?
It was them other fucking flunkies. The Hank Shockers, okay, and the Bill Stephanies and the punk-ass Russell Simmons and the rest of them. And by the way, if you're taking up opposition to what I'm saying, call me. My number is 678-557-2919. Them motherfuckers can get it, for real.
How did Lior Cohen, who's Jewish himself, how did he react to it?
Yo, Bill Adler, Lior Cohen, Ron Scola, Moskowitz, Kara Lewis, all the Jews that I was working with at that time, we had mature adult discussions. It wasn't this childish shit like, give me my ball, I'm going home, nobody's gonna play kickball. Because the information that I gave in the interview wasn't from Griff, it was from Jewish scholars. I didn't write it. So it's like, wow, okay.
So, if Chuck D wanted you in the group, and Chuck D was the leader of the group, why weren't you still in the group?
I'm gonna be honest with you. I'm gonna take the high road and humble myself. That's something Chuck gotta search his heart about. You talk about a man that I came up with since 4 years old. That brother know my heart. Like these two gentlemen I'm sitting in front of. I ain't no fucking ruthless, violent dude like that. I came in this motherfucker telling jokes. You understand what I'm saying? That's my natural character. When I read the contract, I clicked on my Professor Griff shit like I'm supposed to. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then now I'm doing an interview being very transparent. So, but he has to search his heart. You understand what I'm saying? If those people on the other side of Public Enemy, not the ones truly out in the street doing the work saving lives, but on the other side of Public Enemy, didn't have the same idea of the ultimate mission and goal of Public Enemy, didn't share the vision, then that's a discussion we needed to have. But to throw me under the bus thinking that was going to be all right? No, that wasn't going to be all fucking right. Hell nah. Everyone from fucking Spike Lee to the rest of them, no, that shit ain't going to be all right.
What was Flavor Flav's take during this time?
He was like, fuck Griff. We ain't need the motherfucker anyway.
Because the two of
you, that was his attitude.
The two of you never really got along anyways, I guess, right?
Never really got along because I'm not smoking drugs with you. I'm not drinking with you. I'm not bagging chicks with you. I'm not, nah.
Yeah. Mm-mm. So I guess there was a press conference where they announced that Professor Griff is now no longer in the group.
Yeah. Ain't that a bitch? A press conference without me there.
Right.
Let me tell you something, man. I'm going to be honest with you and very transparent. If I would have showed up at the press conference, I would have rearranged that motherfucking furniture in that place. Me and about 20 dudes. But I'm a humble dude.
You're now out of the group. Public Enemy drops Fear of a Black Planet.
No, I'm still there because I was kicked out and brought back.
Uh-huh.
Because Chuck was...
Okay.
Chuck was searching his heart. We went through a period of time, cried together, walked together, broke bread together. And it was like, man, I know we're supposed to disband the group, but it's doing this, it's doing that. We got to look out for the people. And blah, blah, blah. And I just had to understand that. You understand what I'm saying? But to get poisoned, shot at, tracked down and hunted, not going for that. I'm back in the group. Fear of a Black Planet is about to happen. I end up at Def Jam. Two little punk-ass fucking white Jewish dudes wanted to talk shit. I'm like, man, I'm not that other dude. Who the fuck you think you talking to? I try to wrap that motherfucker typewriter around that motherfucker's head. I'm talking about MC Search. And my argument with him wasn't about Jewish people. It was about him disrespecting Malcolm X and black people in front of the Audubon Ballroom when Malcolm X got assassinated. And I'm like, I stepped in the room. I'm like, the rest of these motherfuckers can sit around and give your bitch ass a pass. I'm not. So I'm like, so they called the police on me. So they called the police. And yeah.
You end up getting into a fight with MC Search from third base?
Yeah, him and his little punk ass little sidekick. What a Pete, whatever the fuck.
Pete Nice. Yeah.
Pete Pussy.
Okay.
Yeah.
And they call the police on you. And at the time, third base is signed to Def Jam.
Well, we're at Def Jam. We're in a room. Yeah. We're having a meeting about the Jewish thing, the disrespect. Everybody's there meeting. And I walk in the room. I walk in the room not knowing there's a fucking meeting about me. That shit had violence written all over it, man. That shit had ass whipping written all over it, for real. I'm sorry. Nah.
I mean, how bad did MC Search get it?
He didn't really get it too bad. That motherfucker got probably hit with the R key and the T key and some other shit, but nah, man.
Okay, so I guess I'm a little confused. So when they initially kicked you out of the group, did Public Enemy disband altogether?
No, they actually stepped it up, which I was shocked. I'm like, is something going on that I don't know about? I don't know.
Okay. So then you're back in the group, Fear of a Black Planet comes out, and then they kicked you out of the group again?
Yep. We met with Minister Farrakhan, had this big discussion. After that conversation, Griff was gone. And then, behind my back, this is 2016, so I'm not saying, I don't know what was going on, but behind my back, I ended up with a recording deal with Luke from the 2 Live Crew.
Right.
I'm not a fucking rapper. I don't know what to do. This motherfucker handed me a check, thousands of dollars, and I got to go to Miami and record what? I was the Minister of Information. Guess who got the deal? Chuck D.
Who got the deal?
Chuck D. So you shaking your head like you putting these pieces together. Come on, man. That's a fucking underhand ass shit. Come on.
So it was basically like a severance package. Saying, we're kicking you out of the group, but here's this record deal. Here's a few dollars.
Yeah, and we're sorry we didn't use Vaseline, motherfucker, but go on about your business.
You're now out of the group. Public Enemy drops...
Fear of a
Black Planet. And then they drop... what was the album after that?
Greatest Misses or... I don't fucking...
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I kind of feel like after Fear of a Black Planet, things started to kind of decline a bit.
Okay, yeah, and it was. But can we just be honest? See, the spirit of it now is not there. Not to say that I was the totality of that spirit. It was the combination of people. The spirit wasn't there anymore. It's like the edge wasn't there. Like, even when I came back, motherfuckers smoking on the bus, white girls, and what the fuck? Drinking. I'm like, God damn. What the... The drilling wasn't as sharp. You understand what I'm saying? The interviews wasn't as edgy. I'm like, what the fuck happened? They call it the militant era. With Professor Griff was the road manager and kind of, yeah. That was the era that people really loved the edginess of Public Enemy. After I left, it was like, yeah, they're all right, but.
Well, how did you end up getting back in the group?
Me and Chuck being friends, having conversations, and to be honest with you, we were always talking to one another. But we couldn't talk to one another in public because everybody else hated my guts. So me and him would always talk. And one day I called him and I said, I'm on Long Island, come meet me. I don't know what to fucking do with an album that you set a deal up for me. Come talk to me, dude. You got some producers I could work with? So we sat down and we talked, and he said, look, I'm going to just tell him, just give me a minute and let me work with everybody. I'm going to tell him you coming back. That's when the He Got Game album for Spike Lee, after his ass threw me under the bus, that's when that whole thing came about. And you talking about hating Professor Griff? Whoo! I don't want to wish that on my worst enemy, bro. They hated my guts. And when you really think about it, for what? Talking about some fucking crackers? We always did that. Shit.
So after that, after the He Got Game album, you were officially back in the group.
Officially back in the group, but spirit wasn't there. Aesthetically speaking, I'm there. People see Griff. I wasn't doing anything with the S1Ws. I was just on stage doing my little parts. That's so I really didn't. Yeah, I had no say so.
Okay.
At one time, I could have said, "No, I was the main one that wrote the set list because I did the choreography." Mm-hmm. Nah. I'm seeing songs that I've never really liked and heard, and let's do this, and all out of whack, and yeah, I was just like, okay, well, whatever.
Right, just wasn't the same after that.
No, it wasn't the same.
Mm-hmm. Right. And, you know, by that time, Public Enemy was not on the charts anymore, the music wasn't reacting the same way. It was a group who had classic songs, but they weren't pushing the boundaries the way they were before.
Yeah. Well, you kind of figure Terminator X had a solo project, Chuck D had a solo project, Flavor, and Griff. And out of us four, I probably had the most. Like, I'm on my 7th, 8th album now. I'm on my 7th book, 5th, 6th album. So yeah. So it was just kind of, it wasn't the same. I'm there, but I'm not there. Yeah.
How did you feel when Flavor Flav came back on under the whole Flavor of Love thing and the reality TV and everything?
You know how I felt. Personally speaking, if you're representing Flavor, then that might be cool, but people don't know you as Flavor. They know you as Flavor from Public Enemy. And I felt you throw me out of the group, Chuck, for talking about what's really going on in the world using scholarly material, but you let that fly? I'm like, come on, man. Oh, I can't do interviews and tell the truth, but this dude can smoke weed, drink, bag bitches, and all kind of shit. Come the fuck on. Come on. Come on. No. You can be a coon on national TV. Burnt face fucking coon on national fucking TV, disrespecting himself, his mama, black people, and Public Enemy, and you let that fly. But Professor Griff stand up for black people and tell the truth about white America and Jewish involvement. But you throw me out of the group. That's how I felt.
Well, granted, it wasn't, even though he is part of Public Enemy, it was a Flavor Flav thing. There was no Public Enemy association with it officially. You know, but I think, I mean, the only time I really remember Chuck D being part of anything was when they did the Flavor Flav roast. And I think in the intro it had Flavor and Chuck together, like in a limo talking.
Well, it was Chuck that took Flavor to Hollywood.
There you have it.
There you have it. So when you say officially, Chuck is a smart man. And I would have probably made a similar move with Flavor. Rather than see him back on drugs and in the street, let me take him to Hollywood. Because he's naturally funny. He a funny looking motherfucker. So he's, you understand what I'm saying? So, bruh, get him a fucking job. Keep him busy. I would have probably made a similar move with Flavor.
Yeah.
Listen, don't let these sharp curse words bother you. This is not my motherfucking language. I'm expressing this the best way I know how. You understand what I'm saying? I'm not angry at them now. But we're talking about these periods of time. You understand what I'm saying?
25 years later, Public Enemy is still touring around the globe on a regular basis to huge, right. huge crowds. I remember, was it maybe a year ago or something? I was watching the NBA Finals and LeBron James had a commercial and Welcome to the Terror Dome was the theme music. You know, Public Enemy just left a huge mark on the culture.
Yeah, because it was not only about the music, it was a movement.
Yeah.
And we spoke outside the context of the CD, outside the context, outside of the songs, we spoke to those things. And tell your cameraman, black people are expressive, we talk with our hands, because you motherfuckers took our language from us and we don't know how to express this shit. So we have to, you know, anyway, he understands.
Right.
Yeah.
So fast forward to this year. There was the Dallas shooter.
Wow, you've been doing some reading. But go ahead, yeah.
Yeah. There was the Dallas shooter that ended up killing a bunch of cops. And when people started digging up who he was and his Facebook pages and his social media and so forth, there's a picture of him with you.
Yeah.
So suddenly everyone's trying to make these connections that somehow Professor Griff is involved in the Dallas shooter and so forth, which I never believed. But
that's not necessarily true. People didn't necessarily try to figure it out. It was a narrative set from the beginning. First, he was with a guy with some damn dashiki. Then it was the picture of me and him. So without a proper narrative or hearing from him, couldn't hear from him because they blew the motherfucker up. Okay, so now people are left to their own interpretation of Griff and the guy that killed some cops.
Okay.
And now I become Public Enemy number one around the country with law enforcement agencies. So now I got to go underground.
Okay.
And now people are saying, I told you that motherfucker was trouble. You understand what I'm saying? So now here I am running for my fucking life. You understand what I'm saying? Because now every cop looking at me like, you know, FBI sitting in front of the house, phone tapped, the whole shit. Yeah. And this is recent. This is only a few months ago. This is July.
Right. So in your own words, was there anything beyond that picture besides just a fan picture?
I mean, listen, I'm gonna be honest with you. I did a lecture. I said at the lecture on stage, I'd like to take a picture with whoever want to take a picture with. I'm cool. He was just one guy in line that I took the picture with. Mm-hmm. We had a brief conversation. He said he dug the music, Public Enemy music and whatever. And it was like, man, he's like, he wanted to get some books about what to study and whatever, whatever, whatever. And I said, there's all kind of vendors here with books, DVDs, whatever. He's like, cool, can we take a picture? We took a picture. I didn't even remember his name. I took a picture with 100 people that day. Mm-hmm. So there's periods of time where I unplugged from the Matrix. That Thursday, I unplugged. By the time I turned my phone back on Friday, my daughter was telling me, Daddy, you got to see this. I'm like, see what? So I'm seeing all kind of news stories about me and the Dallas shooter. So immediately took the battery out of the phone, discarded it, jumped in my car, had my man take me to the airport. I got the fuck out of Dodge. Okay. I ended up in Wilson, North Carolina, where nobody could find me. And then I made my way to Tulsa, Oklahoma, where I know they wouldn't be looking for me. And they ass found my ass with a fucking camera crew and the whole shit. So I was like, so I had to face it. Yeah.
But there was nothing really to face. It was a picture.
Thank you.
After a lecture.
Let me tell you something, man. When I stepped off the plane after one Public Enemy tour and them motherfuckers took me to the jail and handcuffed my ass and took me to the jail up under the Hartsfield Atlanta airport and asking me all kind of questions about who are these white people that I'm with in Europe? Do I know that he's part of, you know, the IRA? Do I know he's part of this organization? And I said, I don't know these people. I just met these people. And I said, well, if you really wanted to send me to fucking prison and arrest me, you'd keep the bracelets on me and I'd be on my way to prison right now. But obviously you don't have shit. You have access to my emails, my phone records, right? So if you really charging me with something, charge my ass or let me go. So they took my passport and they took my driver's license. So I couldn't go anywhere. They mailed me my driver's license back and they kept my passport. And that's what it's been since 2008. And 2008, the gentleman that I was working with at the particular time, Khalid El-Hakim, who was a Detroit school teacher, they bombed his classroom and my house was on fire damn near at the same time.
Your house was on fire.
Burned down.
And who do you think did it? Okay.
Let's just say the Alphabet Boys.
Okay.
Whatever one of them alphabets you want to put together, I don't care. FBI, CIA, whoever the fuck. IMF, international motherfuckers, I don't give a fuck.
When you say that your phone was being tapped, how did you know that it was being tapped?
You really asking me that question?
Yeah.
What's the last time you've been to the movies, man? There's a whole born supremacy, born intimacy, born identity, born whatever the fuck. That stuff ain't no fake shit. That's real. They just putting it on the screen in front of you because your ass won't believe it. It's called hidden in plain sight. I know how these people work. You understand what I'm saying?
Okay, so you're telling me that you would have a private conversation over the phone with somebody and something in that conversation would somehow come back out through a third party?
Yeah, of course. Or you have GPS in your car?
Yeah.
Same technology. They have facial recognition software. Same people, same technology. It's not voice recognition. You remember Whitney Houston did those AT&T commercials? The True Voice?
Mm-hmm.
That's voice recognition. Now, fucking cars talk to you, right or wrong. Phones talk to you. TVs talk to your ass. Same technology. What the fuck? That ain't hard to figure out. You pick up the remote, find me sports, and it goes to the channel. Come the fuck on, man. That was years ago. It's just that I was on my job, and I knew that technology existed. I ain't stupid.
I mean, when it comes to hip-hop, one of the big themes that always seems to stand is the Illuminati. What's your take on the Illuminati?
Now, not then when I was talking about it. Here we go again, same period of time, house got burned down. I was talking about the Illuminati.
Okay.
I kept it to myself. I didn't say anything for years. I did two interviews. Here I go with the interviews again. I did two interviews. I was writing the book. It was in my computer at my house. House burned down, lost the book. So I'm like, but the Illuminati was just that organization, that name, that secret society that I kind of put out there to let people know there is a secret society that's controlling all of this, especially the moves that's being made in the music industry. I have flow charts, gave names, everyone from the Vivendi on down to the regular peon at the record companies.
Well, you've had some theories about Tupac, Quincy Jones, and so forth. Do you want to talk about those?
We talked about everything else. We might as well. let me say before you ask the question so the people can, yeah.
Well, I kind of prefer for you to say it because when I saw the interviews.
Well, let me say it. Yeah. Well, inside of certain organizations, Illuminati being the umbrella, secret societies and sub-secret societies, all of them have rituals. I equated some of those rituals with what was going on in the music industry. How does a person come from having a little bit of talent to being a multimillionaire overnight with no talent? You must know someone. So it's not what you know, it's who you know. So I started naming the names and going through the rituals that they were going through in order to bind them to these people. So I pulled some rituals from Skull and Bone Secret Society, from the OTO, from other secret societies, other rituals. And I started equating it to what was going on in the music industry. And there's a homosexual ritual that goes on in certain secret societies. I said, that's the same thing that's going on in the music industry. And I was correct, because later on, people started admitting what was going on, i.e. Cat Williams admitted what was going on at the mansion parties. DMX started talking about what was going on. Tupac, Michael Jackson, I could call a roll. So Professor Griff was absolutely 1,000% correct. Homosexual acts were going on, and this is how people were getting deals, keeping deals, getting put on, the whole bit. Now, these rappers brag about sucking dick and doing whatever the fuck they do to get these deals.
Do they? I've never heard of this.
Shit, do your research.
Okay. But, I mean, I guess, the one thing that sort of raised an eyebrow with me is that, you know, you said that Tupac was killed because he didn't want to engage in these types of acts?
Not necessarily for that particular reason. I think they had Tupac in their sights already. You understand what I'm saying? But now when they assigned a handler to Tupac, maybe even unbeknownst to Tupac, and that man approached you with sexual favors and this trying to control Tupac and he buck, that's all right. We can't neutralize him, so we have to deal with him another way.
Well, I mean, I've studied the Tupac story pretty carefully. Mm-hmm. I've talked to the people that were there at the time that he was killed, people that were there before, you know, some of the law enforcement people that were on the scene and mm-hmm. you know, investigated and so forth. I mean, from my point of view, with everyone that I've talked to that are not connected to each other at all, you know, I've even talked to people connected to, you know, the guy that he, you know, got into a fight with and so forth. Yeah. It seems pretty straightforward. Whereas he gets into a fight with someone who's known to be a killer, who's known to have, you know, to be part of a violent, you know, a violent group. They beat him up. This guy is known to shoot at people for stuff like this. And then a couple hours he gets shot.
Wait, it seems pretty straightforward to me. That's not straightforward. If you watch the footage, there was about 8 people stomping and kicking this dude. How come they didn't get shot too?
Well,
I've been in those kind of fights. You understand what I'm saying? I'm getting names and fucking addresses. You understand what I'm saying? So nah, don't run that down to me. No. Can I ask you a question?
I mean, sure, go ahead.
Who bailed Tupac out of jail?
Suge Knight.
Before that. He was the only one to put the money up? He was the only one to put the money up?
Interscope Records.
So Jada and Will Smith had nothing to do with it?
I didn't know about that. I didn't know. Okay, I mean, well, I know that the Jada Pinkett, I know that Jada went to go visit Tupac in jail. I didn't know that she put up any bail.
Well, you and I will probably have to have this conversation at another time. Okay. And you need to pick up the book, The FBI's War on Tupac Shakur and Black Leadership by John Patash.
Okay.
All right. Well, I mean, John Patash used FBI files. You understand what I'm saying?
And yeah, I mean, you know, you can look at COINTELPRO and you know that the FBI has done a lot of fucked up shit when it comes to the black community.
Yeah, and I don't know what makes people think that they wasn't working on me. I don't want to be on no fucking no-fly list. I want my passport back. I don't want to be hunted down like a fucking animal. This ain't no glamorous shit to be. What the fuck?
So you still don't have your passport to this day?
No. And shit is still happening to me.
You can't fly...
Wait, we talking Dallas shooter shit happened in July. These motherfuckers are still on. They know I'm here in the studio with JR, my man here. There ain't no secret.
Okay, so this means that you cannot leave the country legally.
I haven't left the country since 08.
Wow.
So all of those Public Enemy tours, I wasn't there.
Wow. Right, because a lot of their tours are overseas.
Exactly. I wasn't there.
Wow. That's crazy. So you can't even apply for a new passport?
You know the lawyer that I had to retain in order to fight that? That's on some really truly having to not what you know. Like, who you got to know somebody. Like, look, this guy is not this. He's not a terrorist. He's not training people to kill cops. There's a long shit that you got to say that I'm not in order for them people to say, okay, we're going to have a hearing on it. See, it's what they're not saying. And what they're not saying is, we have found nothing on this guy. I don't remember the last time I got a fucking traffic ticket.
But they still have your passport.
Thank you. So you tell me what that's about for real.
Wow, like I've never even heard of this before. I mean, because you figure if they take your passport, they would arrest you in the process, right?
I've never been arrested in my life.
Right, so how did they take your passport without charging you with anything?
They call it detaining you.
for 8 years now, almost 9 years?
They neutralizing me, so I won't affect other people in other countries. And Skype ain't gonna work.
That's
crazy. Those conversations I don't have that's being recorded that they're probably worried about.
I hear people getting deported. Like, for example, you know, my man Shine, who I talk to sometimes, you know, once he got out of jail, they revoked his U.S. citizenship and he had to move back to Belize. And he's not allowed to come back to the U.S. But I've never heard of anyone in the U.S. who they took their passport from, who can't travel outside the U.S.
Yeah, but they dug up all kind of shit. I don't care if it was an alimony case, a child support case. Anything that they can find to use, they'll put a combination of those things together to use it. But we've known cases where people have had drug charges, murder charges, and all that kind of stuff, and can travel freely. But they won't let me travel. What is it? Now, y'all just met me. So what is it about me? You understand what I'm saying? I ain't got goons that follow me and travel with me and roll with me. I came here by myself. What is it about this hour-long interview that they've dug into my mind and they kind of figure out he's a fucking threat? Neutralize him.
When Barack Obama was running for president, I'll be honest, I didn't think, you know, growing up in America, I was born in Russia, but I grew up in America since I was 5 years old. Seeing the type of racism that I've seen in this country, I didn't think that I would see a black president in my lifetime. But lo and behold, Barack Obama gets elected. How did you feel before the election when you saw that, wow, like we're actually going to have a black president for the first time ever?
That dynamic I had discussed with groups of people a long time ago. America creates these kind of characters when she needs them. Let's look at it. Who's in the news now?
Trump.
Other than his punk ass, who else is in the news? Black. Kaepernick. Right?
Okay.
Let's just say, right? And they create these kind of characters because we could just ignore them. White America can ignore them. The government can ignore them. And it will be nothing to talk about. Because if they say they'd rather black people protest silently and quietly, that's what he did. But you're still making noise. Do you understand what I'm saying? So they create these kind of characters when they need them. And they needed someone that was going to basically lull black people back to sleep so they can set the pick for your man, Trump.
On a certain level, you have children, right?
Yes, grown children.
Right. When children grow up, there's a certain level of emulation. And seeing someone do something makes that child feel that that's actually possible.
Right.
Before Barack Obama, regardless of what you say about Barack Obama, whether you agree with what he did or disagree, Do you feel that on a certain level, he has shown black children in America and around the world that someone that looks like them is able to hold the highest position in the land?
Yes,
and
sir.
In a certain way, that's inspirational.
Oh, very much so. Very much so, yeah. We don't even have to elaborate on that. That's just what it is. Yeah. I love to see a black family coming out of a White House.
Right. Right. And everybody loves Michelle Obama. Everyone loves their two daughters. You know, people
two
actually
beautiful
felt that,
children.
Yeah.
And the black dog. Yeah, I got you. Okay.
No type of bullshit. You know, no scandals. No mistresses. No Monica Lewinsky's.
I don't know about that.
Well, none that I know of.
You didn't hear the gay thing? The homosexual ritual?
Oh, earlier in the conversation?
No, with Barack Obama, he was Barry.
Never heard of that.
Yeah, we'll talk about it.
Never heard about that. Yeah. I mean, now that Obama's leaving office, how do you feel about his presidency?
Barack Obama?
Yeah.
Some bullshit. What the fuck did he do for the last 8 years? Except get gray hair. If you talk to any black person, they'll tell you he didn't come speak to us. He talked to Jews, gays, and all kind of other people. Russians, he ain't never come talk to us. Shit.
Well, I think that Obamacare with pre-existing conditions, I think that was a major thing for America. I mean, it's even to the point where the Republicans want to strike down Obamacare, but they don't want to get rid of pre-existing conditions. I think that was one of the most criminal things ever created in America. You know, let's just say you get cancer, you get AIDS, you get some sort of very serious condition and you don't have health insurance. When you try to sign up for health insurance, they'll let you sign up, but they'll say, but we're not going to cover this because signed up.
Yeah. But that's like,
I thought that,
that's like giving them the Nobel Peace Prize. Okay, and next. Okay. No, I'm not going for it, bro.
No?
No, not going for it. No, not at all. Until not you all. Come down here and you know what's ailing black people, for you to do that and not understand where we've come from to where we are now, to know that there has to be an educational component that comes with your healthcare agenda, then what good are you just, you profiling? They say on the West Coast, you high side, man. No. Nah, man. Then there's an educational component that comes with that.
What about the defunding of private prisons?
Did you see the documentary 13th? It's not.
I heard about it.
It's not what they say while we're on the camera. It's not how I act while I'm in front of the camera. It's when these cameras go off, is when you see the real Griff. You understand what I'm saying? So come on, man. We've been bullshitted and messed around by every president. It's the same old agenda, man. So you defund it, but at the same time, prior to that, and while he's on his way out, you put your energy behind Hillary Clinton.
Okay.
Whose husband is responsible for mass incarceration. Come on, bruh.
Right, right. I mean, although he did take a lot of nonviolent drug offenders and reduce their sentences.
Yeah, so you stab me in the back with a knife 9 inches and you pull the shit out 3 and you make me a fucking birthday cake. Fuck off. That bullshit. The knife is still in my back, man. Come the fuck on.
Okay.
Nah.
I mean, were you surprised that Trump won?
That's a good question. To a degree, yeah. I'm like, you grabbing pussy and doing all this shit, you could not. People are smart enough to say, nah, we can't do this dude. We really can't do Hillary, but him, no. But that morning, I'm like, nah, man, he didn't, for real, he won. They're like, yo, he won. I'm like, wow, maybe that's a good thing for black people. Now we can get the fuck up off our asses and do something for ourselves. Shit, about time.
I mean, when I talk to people about Trump, I get very different answers. And the one thing that I hear from certain people is, certain black people that I interview, is that they like Trump because they want to see the racism. They don't want to hear, they don't want someone who smiles in their face and is secretly racist behind their back. They like to know that this is a racist person that they're dealing with. And that's what Trump is bringing out in this country.
Let me tell you something. If I walked out of this room right now and met a girl who that looked beautiful, and I said, although that you might have AIDS, I still like you. I still like you because you bring AIDS awareness to me after we left the hotel. Come on, stop that, bro. That's foolish. I don't like Trump. I don't like racism. Now, if he's bringing it and he's overtly racist and he's bringing certain aspects of racism, white supremacy to my attention, I got that lesson. But I don't like you, dude. You understand what I'm saying? I just don't like the kind of person he is. I don't like him for America. Hell, I could be bold enough to say I don't like him for white people. Because Trump is going to get some white boys kicked in the motherfucking teeth, for real. Because they're real cocky right now, in my L.A. voice.
Yeah.
They're real cocky right now, for real. But anyway.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like under Trump, racists feel like they could express themselves the way they couldn't four years ago.
They've always had silently, but now, overtly, they're going to put the T-shirt back on. Fuck niggas.
Yeah.
Go back to your own country. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, I don't like it.
Me either. Under Barack Obama, there was a certain kind of, because we were into what we were into, like I could meet you at Starbucks and see you with the camera. We could have a discussion and we won't even think white and black. We talking about cameras. You understand what I'm saying? There was just a certain kind of, but with Trump, bruh, it's almost like you use the bathroom, flush the toilet, and the shit don't go away. It's like, damn. And you in somebody else's bathroom. Now they're going to come behind you and see all your shit. Like, he's putting it right in front of you. Like, here it is. But it's forcing us, both black and white, to deal with it. Now let's deal with it. Now let's see how both sides act. Am I going to retreat back into my ultra-black, radical, militant, militantism, so to speak? Or white people going to retreat back and some going to put on the hood and some going to reveal their swastika and are we going to retreat back and become haters of one another again? And you know something? It's going to bring the worst and the best out of all of us, man.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
I agree. Professor Griff, it was definitely a pleasure.
Oh, give thanks, man.
You know, a longtime fan of your movement.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. And what you represent. You know, hopefully you get your passport back. You know, this is something.
I won't end up in Russia. I was on my way to Russia. They pulled me out of the line. 15 of us singled me out, put the bracelets on me, and tell me I can't get into Russia because I don't have enough pages in my passport to support a visa.
Mm. Yeah. You know, and I think, you know, a lot of people are going to watch this and say, well, who cares about a passport? I don't travel anyways. But I think that's one of the big tragedies with I think most of Americans who don't really travel out of this country. Because I could tell you like a personal story with me. Growing up in America, with the tension between black and white, I just assumed that this was just, that's just how humans work. People look different, so they don't really get along, and there's always going to be a tension and so forth. And I remember the first time I went to Africa in the year 2000, I was in Senegal. And as I walked around Africa, and as I, you know, as I met people and just saw people on the street, and I realized that tension between races wasn't there, it suddenly dawned on me that this was not a human thing, it was an American thing, based on the history with slavery and sort of the way things were engineered for hundreds of years, that this is just not the way humans work. When you look at babies of different races, they're not, you know, they play with each other like it doesn't really matter. And traveling to other countries, traveling to Africa, traveling to Europe, you know, traveling to the Middle East, traveling to Australia, to Asia, has taught me so much that I know how much of a tragedy it is that you don't have a passport right now.
And right, exactly.
To everyone who has a passport out there watching this right now, definitely start to travel because you're going to look at life a lot differently.
Yeah, and my thing is traveling, you get to see other cultures hands on, like, you understand what I'm saying? In their native lands. And you get to experience different things. And as I traveled, and I think that's what aspects of what the government was kind of allude to, that I'm meeting people that were white British dudes that think like I do. Irish dudes, radical. There's a woman, I can't mention her name in England, radical as fuck. She's a blonde-haired, blue-eyed woman. So I'm like, wow. And I was growing and expanding and meeting different people that thought like I thought on a global level.